Adawadi as graphic designer, book designer and curator. She researched the works of Dr. Moshe Spitzer, who was one of the editors beside Lambert Schneider at the Schocken Publishing House in Berlin. And Ada worked on the story of Moshe Spitzer and his publishing house Tarshish in Jerusalem, which he opened after he immigrated. But Ada will tell more about this. And she published a book on Spitzer, a beautiful book, which was published in 2016, together with her father and Meron Ehren. She curated the exhibition's New Types, Three Pioneers of Hebrew Graphic Design at the Israel Museum Jerusalem in 2015-16. An exhibition that also traveled to Leipzig in a smaller kind of format afterwards. And she was the curator, as I said before, of ACTA, the Hebrew University Jewish Scholars and the Exile from Europe at the National Library of Israel. Adawadi lives and works in Tel Aviv, and she's now getting closer to Zalman Schocken's publishing house with her talk, Save the Stock. So Adawadi.
This outline was drawn by Dr. Moshe Spitzer on a printed proof of the book Selected 70s. In a freehand, Spitzer marked the exact place of the poem in non-symmetric lines, drew the opening letter, the running title, and the indicator. The book was published in honor of the 17th birthday of Zalman Schocken and held 70 poems, which were selected by members of the Research Institute of Hebrew Poetry. It was published in 70 copies on soft, refined paper, printed in Haaretz Printing House at the order of Schocken's son Gershom in September 1947. 10 years earlier, a bibliophile edition of 40 copies of the book Yamim Noraim, Days of Awe, came out in the honor of Schocken's 60th birthday. The book, edited by Shai Agnon, held texts, legends, slichot, and rules relating to Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Spitzer initiated publication of this book already in 1934, and he followed all stages of its progress, corresponded frequently with Agnon in Jerusalem. The book was printing in Drogolin Printing House, Leipzig, which acquired especially for this project the most beautiful Hebrew type for monotype, writes the manager Schneider to Schocken. Many proofreadings, some of them in Agnon's handwriting, were found in Spitzer Archive. In August 30, 1937, Spitzer writes to Agnon, "Because of the new laws and orders, we had to hurry in order to publish the Almanach as well as the book for Yamim Noraim. Your request to publish Yamim Noraim in a special edition was cited also by Schocken. One of these copies is kept in Schocken Library, bound in blue leather, the edge of the pages tinted in gold." In honor of that day, Dr. Spitzer and Lambert Schneider also printed a facsimile edition of the first copy of Palms with Kimchi comments, dated end of 15th century. In one of these copies, there is a letter from Spitzer and Schneider to Schocken. This print is the first of Bible prints in its Hebrew types. After having succeeded to find a rare copy which is clean and whole, we decided to photograph, copy, and print it in a limited numbers, and thus credit the public, but especially to delight the heart of book lover, erudite, and Mr. Zalman Schocken. This is why we dedicate this first form of an edition of 600 books. We, directors of Schocken Publishing House in Berlin, Moshe Spitzer and Lambert Schneider, October 1937. 10 years separates between these books, years of abyss and days of awe. Schocken Publishing House in Berlin closed down. Most of its readers were annihilated in the war. Schneider was drafted to the German army and deserted later. Moshe Spitzer reached Palestine at the last moment, and Zalman Shoken immigrated to the United States. Yet these books symbolize a persistent, timeless sequence, an ongoing gift to Zalman Shoken, patron of the Hebrew culture, which feeds on the roots of the Jewish culture, perfectly designed in splendor and glory, fit for culture heritage, as if there is no war in the world, not in Germany, nor in Jerusalem. But between the war and the splendid books, everyday life was going on. Life of the publishing house, life of the people who worked there, and were moving between commitment to the publishing's vision and facing the imminent growing danger to their own life. I would like to draw here generally and cordially few lines about the major part Spitzer took in Shoken Publishing House in Berlin as editor, designer, and manager, and who had in the last year of the publishing existence take care of closing its gates and send the book stock to Jerusalem. Most of the material which document the last year of the publishing house is lost. The letters which I will quote should not be considered as evidence documents. They are random and were saved by chance, written in a personal tone, reflecting the zeitgeist of those days and the mood of the person who wrote them. This is also the spirit of the interviews which Dr. Spitzer gave to Dov Kulka of the Institute of Contemporary Jewry, and often an interview with Halit Yashurun published in Chadarim magazine. But first and foremost, I would like to thank Spitzer family who opened his archive to us, to Stephanie Maher who found and translated some of the letters in Shoken archive, to Dina Vardi and Adil Livni who helped in translating, to Baruch Rinon for his knowledge and help, and to Caroline Yassen who paved the way to catalog Spitzer archive and helped me continuously in my research and invited me to speak here this morning. The relationship between Shoken and Spitzer began towards the end of the 20s in Berlin. Spitzer worked as a private Hebrew tutor for Shoken's children. This served as added income to his earning from work in Prussian Academy of Science and as a director of Jewish Evening College for Youth. Spitzer had returned to Berlin from the University of Kiel, where he concluded his PhD in Indian Studies. He had moved from Berlin to Kiel, hoping to free himself from his Zionist activities in which he was engaged since youth. In 1916, 16 years old, he began to correspond with Martin Buber. He wrote to him, "Okay, now we know we are Jews and we should be Jews. We know we are Zionists and need to be Zionists, but what to do?" One of Buber's reply letters to Spitzer that year opened with, "To my fellow traveler." Indeed, this was the beginning of a long relationship between the two and their collaboration in Jewish education activities. Jewish education activity and operational plans were also the base of Spitzer's idea for a Jewish publishing house, as expressed in a letter Spitzer sent to Shoken in 1930. The political disillusion strengthened the need for cultural activity and spiritual consequence everywhere. A publishing house practicing both virtues and based on enough capital, and therefore not limited production, could quickly take over a position of spiritual leadership in the entire Hebrew book production. You were always ready to support the Jewish culture work. This induces me to submit my ideas to you, all the more so because I'm convinced that their realization calls for investments, but not expensive on lost costs. I do not know what was Schocken's answer to the young teacher, but maybe this letter plus discussion which followed paved the way for the senior position Spitzer will hold in the publishing house which Schocken established in 1931. In 1932, Schocken sends Spitzer to Oppenheim in order to help Buber in translation of the Bible to German after the sudden death of Rosenzweig, Buber's partner. The translation project had been started by the publisher Lambert Schneider, who encountered financial difficulties and asked Schocken for assistance. Schocken agreed and acquired from Schneider Publishing House its Judaica books and made Schneider director of Schocken Publishing House. When Spitzer returned to Berlin from Oppenheim, Schocken appointed him editor working alongside Schneider. The need for cultural activity and spiritual awareness became sharper during 1933 when the Nazi came to power and in view of racial law which defined for many people for the first time their Jewish identity. Spitzer tells Kulka about his feeling of commitment during those days. I felt confident to conform the changes of those days. We were alive for this time and had to pass the days somehow. The question was how, in despair and deterioration or in looking for the significance of what befell them. In other words, they realized and accepted their Jewish identity and one had to give them the means which helped them, which helped to explain to themselves this destiny and to value it. This commitment guided Spitzer as editor of the Bucherei books, which were first published in 1933 and continued until 1938, altogether 83 volumes. And I quote from Kulka, "Cultural we had aimed very high, Jewish writing, excluding apologetic and sentimental matters. But during summer 1933, I became convinced that this literature, which considers cakes and raisins for the highbrow reader, become under the new circumstances loaf of bread. The first volume was Yeshayahu chapter 40 verse 1 in Hebrew with Buber's translation. The message for the Jews was comfort and hope. Do not despair. Such things have happened before. Later we included poetry, even jokes in Yiddish by Oswanger, and later even two volumes of the Rambam, one after the other. The reaction was excellent. Books were sold by dozens. Some were printed in 2-3 editions. We even received order from the intellectual who left the country. Later, we included Jewish writers who wrote on non-Jewish subjects, choosing the best to our taste. And this is how we published Kafka and some of Strauss. The format of Schocken's Bucherei, the cover design using an etiquette at the front and the uncompromised quality of the books were almost identical with the Insel books, which were so much identified with German culture. In a memorial to Spitzer, Gershom Schocken talked about the aesthetic revolution which his father wanted to lead within the Zionist movement with Spitzer at his side. He described Schocken's recall from provincial and ugly appearance of the Jewish books, which he felt marked them and their readers as outsiders. Schocken rejected it and wanted that the appearance of Jewish culture will be updated with the area aesthetic codes and its technological innovation. And indeed, the Bucherei books could stand on the bookshelf near German books as an equal neighbor. In the mid-30s, Zalman Schocken immigrated to Palestine. Schocken continued to be involved in all details, but responsibility, daily management, as well as decision and plans were actually in the hands of Schneider and Spitzer. In spite of the hard economic and political situation in Germany at the time, the publishing house was thriving, and German and Hebrew books were published in addition of the Bucherei, such as Kafka, Shai Agnon, Middle Age Hebrew poetry, as well as modern poetry. Towards the end of 1937, Spitzer writes to Bubel, "I know the end is coming, and if I am still willing work on this or that book, it is like a man who knows his end is near and is starving to make the best for the days that there are still left." That year, all Jewish publishing houses' work was limited and concerned. They were all put under the control of the Kulturbund, an institute which was to cover all cultural Jewish activities and was under the supervision of the Nazi propaganda ministry. The Schocken publishing house were obligated to get their approval on each book they wanted to publish. Spitzer had to meet often with the head of the Jewish department in the Nazi propaganda ministry. And he tells Kulka about the special relationship with this person. "One day I had to go to the Jewish department in the propaganda ministry. Of course, I went with mixed feeling, but there surprise waited for me. The director was a young man who received me cordially. Soon he started to tell me his personal opinions, his life story. He was an SS man, son of a priest, who studied Bible since childhood. He confessed to me that in his view, the Jewish situation should aim at dissimulation. A Jew should not be allowed to have a key position in German culture. On the other hand, when Jews are involved in Jewish culture activity, he will respect it. He gave me to understand that he was especially influenced by Bubel. Maybe this is why he feels sympathy towards the Schocken publishing house." These talks were sometimes quite grotesque, and once he said to me, "You understand that this is not the place to enlarge on this topic. Maybe we should meet somewhere else." Spitzer's connection with this head of department at the propaganda did not prevent the confiscation of one of the book deliveries to Palestine, which Spitzer tried to stand a year later. On November 9, 1938, all Jewish institutions were closed down, and German found a big cellar full of books. Before they began investigating, they were told, "This is where books are gathered in order to be sent to the Hebrew University in Jerusalem," an action which had been agreed upon with the German. They opened one box to see which books, and unfortunately, the top book was the first edition of Kleist. He said, "Well, this has to be inspected." Closed the box, sealed it, and asked the clerk if there are more books somewhere. The clerk said, "No, just one transport of 96 boxes on the way to Hamburg to be shipped to Palestine." So they stopped also the transport, to which I had added 6 boxes with my books. I tried to tell the propaganda person that I have a personal interest in the matter, in the hope that it will motivate him, knowing his personal attitude towards me, but nothing helped. On March 1938, Schocken separated the publishing house from the chain of the department store, thus cutting off its financial source. A new company was established and named, according to the race laws, Schocken Jewish Publishing House, of which 95% belonged to Theodor Schocken and 5% to Spitzer. It became clear to Spitzer and Schneider that the time has come to begin closing the publishing house and to plan how to save the existing stock of the books. They were in Berlin, coping daily with the destruction of the work of the publishing house, as well with growing danger on their own life, but they did not succeed to convey this to Schocken, who was outside Germany and who probably found it hard to realize that the work of his life is crumbling to pieces. In September 1938, Spitzer had fled from Germany. He writes from Amsterdam to Schocken, with whom he's supposed to meet later in London, asking help to arrange a proper visa, as he's afraid he might be detained by the German because of his Czech passport. 10 days later, September 26, still waiting for reply, Spitzer sent another letter. He would like to return to Berlin just one more time in order to close matters of the publishing house with the liquidator. He asked for Schocken's advice about the stock of the books and report to him about the overall situation. In case of war, we would have to export as fast as possible and as much as possible on regular accounts, even through payment would not be possible anymore. On the other side, it would be safer to wait for the new positive list of Ha'avara, which hopefully contains Jewish books as one of the items. This list is supposed to be made public this week. Spitzer goes on to tell the difficulties it is to continue the operation of the publishing house. Schneider was drafted last Sunday as an automobilist. For the last few days, his location is unknown. This is after he was able to go home for the night during the first day. I try to keep contact with the Verlag and liquidators by constant correspondence and more regular phone calls. This will work for a certain amount of time, but soon a managing director has to be there. The censor board become unbearable. A German production had begun through their extensive delusion, apart from anything else, extremely problematic. Spitzer succeeded to return to Berlin. Schneider is temporarily released, and in autumn 1938, the two published the last almanac of Schocken Publishing House. Spitzer had to struggle to fill the almanac content, which was censored again and again. As he did for each almanac, Spitzer translated to German a story by Agnon. For this edition, he chose the story In the Forest and in the City. In addition, he chose and translated four poems dating back to the poet Yanai, beginning by Byzantine period. When enemy and persecutor is after you, our eyes beseech your love. The almanac closed with a sketch by Max Liebermann showing a Jew praying, and following that, there are 16 pages of statistic tables demonstrating clearly and actually the destruction of Jewish life in Germany and the revival of Jewish life in Palestine. On October 31, 1938, Schocken writes to Schneider, almost from a parallel world, and asks him to deal with two subjects: the question of printed limited edition and the problem of making small typefaces. He refers Schneider to a special report written by Spitzer, which deal with special typefaces created by their company Augustine for footnotes. The types are far from being immaculate, but they can do, because it is a type which was produced very quickly and without great care. This example makes me deal again with this matter, because we lack here the opportunity to produce types which are not perfect, but which can be used for test. I guess this procedure is only applicable in connection with monotype. Maybe I will pay a visit in London. I ask you to send the materials and your notes on it to London, Hotel Dorchester. From Hotel Dorchester, after Kristallnacht, Schocken writes in Hebrew to Spitzer, asking for more news. He suggests several places where they can meet and ends the letter. Even if there are little chance that we could discuss in our meeting practical business problems, I would like to discuss your situation. The two meet in London, and the discussion moved from practical to personal issues. Spitzer tried to persuade Schocken to liquidate the company. He tells Kulka Schocken's answer: I understand that you do not want to stay, but there are still Jews in Germany and one has to do some things for them. You should look for a substitute before you leave, someone who will continue the work. The vast gap between Spitzer and Schocken about how to save the stock of book caused bitter arguments between the two. Schocken insisted on saving the monetary value of the books in spite of the hard times, and he was apprehensive of Spitzer's plan to save the stock which was sometimes illegal. It is understandable that they gave different version about the way the books were sent. And Spitzer tells more Kulka. There was an order to transfer all books to the Kulturbund, and I knew that this would mean that all was lost. So I planned a conspiracy as if Zalman ordered a large amount of books in dollars in price of 10 or 5%, and that he gave me permission to export the books. That meant that I was obligated to give the Kulturbund a certain amount of copies of each book, and the rest amount could be sent out, which was 155-ton books. Only this way did I succeed to transfer the books to Israel. The period between worrying about how I get myself and my belongings out and the worries about the books, all this was was nerve-wracking experience, but the books are here, and I came to the country a few days before Pesach. In April 1939, Spitzer arrives to Jerusalem and settles in a pension in Beit HaKerem. He's invited to celebrate the Seder night at Schocken's home. Then next day, Schocken informs him that he will not continue to work in the publishing house, so he is actually unemployed. Schocken offers as compensation a 1-year salary, but Spitzer is insulted and rejected the offer. Instead, Spitzer prepares a detailed report to the overall condition of the company, including review of collections which were left in Berlin, a plan for a new Hebrew series, an outline for continued work on scientific publication, question relating publishing rights of Agnon, Kafka, etc. While still in Beit HaKerem, Spitzer corresponds with Schocken's liquidator, Mr. Wasserman, and in affidavit he complained after 1948, Spitzer mentioned his account with Mr. Wasserman and elaborates the damage caused by the unforced liquidation and his hired escape. And he writes there, "My part in Schocken Jewish Publication Ltd. amounts to 5,000 Reichmarks, 25% from total property. Lost, it's all lost values as a result of enforced liquidation. My damage totals are at least 5,000 Reichmarks." In another section, he gives in details the content of the 6 boxes with books from his private library, which were confiscated along with the Schocken transport. I do not know how to explain Spitzer's demand for 25% of value of Schocken Publishing House. Unknown is also the fate of the books. But in 1953, Spitzer published a first Hebrew edition of Michael Kohlhaas by Kleist, the same book which caused confiscation of the whole stock of books. The book was published by Tarshish Publishing House, which Spitzer established in Jerusalem in 1940. The text in the book is accompanied by woodcuts made by Yaakov Pintz, and the book design is severe and strict, almost as the story itself. Tarshish was a small publishing house, certainly not profitable as Schocken Publishing House in Berlin, but its impact and influence on bookmaking in this country was enormous. The high quality of content and form echoed the years in Berlin, but in opposite direction. Now Spitzer wanted to open the gates for the world to enter into Jerusalem and thus enrich the Hebrew culture also with properties of European culture.